Welcome back. Let's have a look at residence time distribution, and we will look at that at first with ideal reactors. Yeah, so that only makes sense in continuous reactors. In discontinuous reactors, we would be looking at mixing time mainly. We will assume ideal behavior of the reactors here, and therefore this is not of any concern yet. So we will now make dynamic experiments. So that's one exception where we will not be talking about the steady state. Actually, this is dynamic behavior, so steady state is not something we want here. Let's have a closer look. So what we will do is to introduce a marker of some kind. Yeah? And this marker is something we can measure, yeah, in its concentration. And at one point in time, we will introduce this marker into the reactor. All at once, which will make this infinitely high, and we will do this for convenience reason at time zero. So let's look what happens to our plug flow rate. Volume flow in and out. So what happens? Rather basically, this will act as a time machine. Yeah, everything which we introduced here will, in an ideal reactor, will be passed from one of these cross sections to the other. Yeah? So what we effectively have is that we have these kind of cross sections in series, and this marker will now jump from one to one to one to one and so on. When will we see it again? Yeah, and that is most conveniently, if we have a volume of the reactor, yeah, this will again be given by our hydrodynamic residence time here. So this is the residence time of our plug flow reactor here, tau PFR, as defined as volume divided by volume flow. And there we will see it all again, all at once. That's all. Kind of time machine here, which will act on that. So that's the one of the two reactors. What happens in a continuous steady tank reactor? Again, we will introduce everything at the same time. Stir it ideally so that we have an instant mixing of these green marker in the reactor. And what we will get as a result we'll put everything in, so we will get a response here which is at its highest here and will be zero after the time it takes it to wash out. As the likelihood of the green marker leaving the reactor is proportional to its concentration reactor, yeah, we have something which is will follow a first order decay, which we know is an exponential function. Okay, and if you look at it a little bit more closely, we have here an initial concentration, yeah, so that is some. Yeah, so that's the amount we put in here divided by the volume of the reactor. This will decline over time. Where do we find our residence time again? So that it would be that we find this concentration as a function of e to the power of our residence time. that is what we will find here. So we have an exponential decay, and as this is governed by residence time here, this will be faster if the residence time is shorter, and of course take longer if residence time is longer. So that is about that. So we find our and for this reason also you find that you will find everything in there, and that's probably also convenient, which you also can do, which is a neat trick there, is that of course that the integral starting from zero here, which is our starting point here, also here, to infinity, will actually have to equal this concentration here, because we have to find our overall concentration that cannot be more, cannot be less, mass balance must be closed. So that is something which I think exemplifies that these kind of integrals can be finite, even though we never reach zero, apparently. And that is the most simple concept you can take. You can take the two continuous reactors, and you see you get totally different residence time behavior, which also, again, explains their behavior or their different performance in reactive settings. And that is the first conclusion we can make at this point. Thank you very much.